Hey, Jerry, did that HDPE come in yet?
No, but your Taylor Swift CDs came in.
Well, I have a wonderful electronic invention I want you to see.
It looks something like this.
Now, in this week's episode, we're talking end effectors. We have six pallet sizes, smallest is 6x10, all the way up to our 10x16-inch pallet for our Pro pallet system. Now, I designed two separate designs for the end effector. I think one is a definite winner. Let's walk into my office. I'll show you why. Okay, so this is the model that's freely downloadable off our website, pearsonworkholding.com. If you go to our Pro pallet page, there's a step file of this. I brought that in. Now this, what you see here, this highlighted surface, that is going to be a raw extruded surface. We keep it raw. We want to give you, the customer, as much material as possible. The locating points that are critical are machined in, being the bores, being the height of where the lock ring is located, and of course, the four pads, which are machined flat. Those are the critical things that we machine into it. So highlighting this blue surface here, where do we pick up this pallet and all the other different sizes of pallets? There's four Pro pallet sizes and two mini pallet sizes. What I did was just brought in both models, and I'm working in Fusion 360. I created a joint between them so they're perfectly centered. And you can see when I overlay them, now I've got this blue area of the mini pallet and this blue area of the face of the Pro pallet. And there's areas that I have to avoid, and there's areas that I can only pick up on within the smallest pallet area, being the 610 pallet. So starting with this, obviously that's all, this blue area is area that I can pick up on. So the first thing I did was I created this vacuum cup. So my original design was, hey, you know, I'll have these four vacuum cups because they avoid the areas of all the machined features in the pallets, and it gets to the extent of the part. It was a decent design. It would have worked. I thought, you know, it'd be really easy if I could just 3D print it instead of machining it. Maybe I'd have maybe some kind of like tubing coming out the back to one central spot, and of course putting the mounting pattern here to interface with the robot's arm. Good, but I have a personal design belief of, when I design something, I design it three times. All of our products, Pro pallet, mini pallet, RotoVice, of course the vacuum systems, they've all been designed three times or more. RotoVice, I think I had five fully featured designs. And then they get better each time. And another thing is they get more simple each time. So this is a decent design. Like I said, it'll work, but it could be more simple. So in my second design, I went with a single cup. And let me rotate that so you can see. Now I've fully featured this. So it has the boss that goes into the center pocket of the arm. And then it has these four through holes that I've counterbored out. Now here's, in vacuum work holding, here's how you find out how much holding force you have. I'm going to highlight these surfaces that are exposed to the vacuum. Now this in here, this is where my vacuum gasket will go. And so everything on the inside of this is gonna be surface area exposed to the vacuum. So this right here, and I'm looking down here, 8.236. So I'm going to get a running total of my surface area, 8.236 plus. And then these areas, we're actually going to think of that being on the surface. So each one of them is 0.5. We'll just say 0.5 times 4 is 2. So plus 2, 10 square inches of surface area, plus these grooves, things like that. I'm gonna multiply that times 14. Now, why 14? 14 is the amount of power that our vacuum power unit will put out. Now, the maximum a vacuum can put out is 14.9 pounds per square inch of holding force. That's actually kind of hard to get that maximum. You have to have lots of energy going into it to get that maximum holding power out. We balance it out, 14 pounds, that's a 94% maximum vacuum. And our VPU only draws 0.8 CFM of required air. That's all it uses, a very small amount. So we're definitely going to go with our vacuum power unit to apply 14 pounds per square inch to this area. Gives me 143 pounds of holding force. Our heaviest pallet is just under 24 pounds. So we've got almost a 6-time factor of safety. So after seeing this, I go, man, this is the design. I think I can just run with this and not go with a third design. Let me show you one more thing. My first inclination is to go with a standard socket cap screw. But then refining that idea, I found this type of cap screw. If I highlight that, it's got this huge diameter head. I mean, look at this thing. That is one single piece. I've never seen that in a hardware store. Definitely gonna go with that because it's gonna give me lots of good surface area. I'm gonna machine this out of probably HDPE, easy material to machine. And it'll give me a lot of surface area so that when it's pulling in, also it'll seal because this is sealing on a vacuum area in here. So I don't have to deal with O-rings or anything like that. It should be fine. We'll find out. Let me program it. We'll go out, machine it, and see how it works. So what you're looking at here is our Pro Pallet system with our vacuum pallet kit. I'll put a card up here in the corner so you can watch another video if you're interested on seeing how that works. But basically, I'm outlining the perimeter of the part with vacuum gasket, and then I'm placing a piece of sandpaper face up to give the part a little more traction. Now, we do this when we're working with smaller parts where our surface area is a little limited. In this case, HDPE is sometimes a little bit slick, and sandpaper, you just can't go wrong with it. Now, I'm just using an adaptive path and some finishing and chamfers and drilling, pretty basic for this first operation. And the second operation is pretty simple. I'm just gonna finish off the backside in a vise. All right. Okay, this part turned out absolutely perfect. Yeah, really happy with it. HDPE, sometimes it moves a lot when it gets machined. This looks pretty darn good. And so I'm gonna say this is a good part. The one thing I'm a little concerned about is holding dimensions in this material. Of course, it's a little flexible, but it's going into this pocket right there, and it should be have very little clearance. Yeah, wow, okay. I think I left like one thou oversized, and I mean, that is just, that's like right there. That's perfect. So let me do this. Let me grab these. So this is those screws that I was telling you about. Just it looks like they have a built-in washer, which is really unique. Now, the nice thing about these is when I install them into this, because it's got all this surface area right in there, it's gonna hopefully create two things. First of all, an airtight seal. So that airtight seal is important, and because it's got such a large surface area, it's also gonna hold the two metal pieces to this relatively, definitely less, or not as strong piece of material here. Because again, this is gonna pick up about 25 pounds worth of parts. So that's gonna go, let me walk over here and grab a wrench really quick. Now, one thing I wanna do is make sure it's pretty centered. It is. All right, that's good. So yeah, I'm happy with that. Let me install this fitting. This is a standard swivel fitting, and that's just gonna go in the top. Of course, HDPE is kind of a self-sealing plastic, so I'm not worried about that. Plug this in, I've routed this to the back of the control that's actuated by the, ultimately it's gonna be actuated by a solenoid, 12-volt solenoid hooked up to the controller box of the robot. So you just program solenoids to open and close. That's what's gonna create the vacuum action. And then finally, our 1/8-inch vacuum gasket. I'm gonna tuck this in all the way around the perimeter. And everything you see here, we're trying to reuse as much of our own product as possible. It's kind of handy when you're a vacuum work holding company and you got everything on a shelf feet away. Okay, now let me get this. Now, in all vacuum applications, 9 times out of 10, the failure point is bad gasketing. I know to cut this as straight as possible and a little bit longer. Okay, so I cut a little extra length and I'm gonna tuck that in, which closes up the gap. A good gap is a gap that you can barely see. So moment of truth, let me walk around back. I'm gonna manually turn on the vacuum source. And we're gonna put our heaviest pallet right up here, see if it holds. Let me go do that right now. Okay, so I picked up an unassembled 10 by 16 inch pallet off our shelf. And just to make it more easy, I just hooked up our vacuum power unit. That sound tells me it's drawing vacuum. Now I know better not to put my hand on this unless I want to get a gnarly hickey. Moment of truth. Man, if I just put this on, in theory, it should just hold. Here goes. That is awesome. I could feel it when I put it up. I was watching the rubber seal. Right when the seal made contact with the surface of the pallet, it just pulled itself in. So this little vacuum cup, that's a power vacuum. It's almost magical. But that little surface area, almost like 3 inch by 4 inch, is holding this 24, 25-ish pound pallet. And it could hold a 140-pound piece of material in theory. The robot can't pick it up, but the vacuum cup could. So I'm gonna say this is a success. And so I'm gonna keep working on what we need to do to get now the machine to hold the pallet more work holding. So if you're interested in seeing that, come back. I'm gonna walk you through all this again. And we're probably gonna divulge a little secret design that I have. It's almost a patentable idea, but I just don't care. I wanna use it in-house. So go ahead. Like this video, subscribe, and we'll catch you next time. Oh, and by the way, go innovate your production.